The Kissimmee River once meandered from the Kissimmee chain of lakes down to Lake Okeechobee. As a result of massive flooding in the region, the river was channelized, negatively impacting the water quality, native plant and animal communities, and the Kissimmee River food web. With the completion of the construction phase of the world's largest river restoration project, the water quality, native plant communities, and wildlife in the Kissimmee River ecosystem are rebounding. Food webs illustrate the interconnectedness, interactions, and energy flow of plants and wildlife within an ecosystem. If one part of the food web is changed, it has cascading effects because everything is connected. The primary energy source in a food web is the sun. Plants use energy from the sun to produce their own food through the process of photosynthesis. Plants are primary producers. In the Kissimmee River food web, the primary producers are wetland plants such as periphyton algae, spatterdock, and smartweed. These plants are eaten by primary consumers. Small fish and aquatic invertebrates such as apple snails, mayfly larvae, and crayfish. Secondary consumers, such as large fish, turtles, and frogs, eat the primary consumers. Finally, secondary consumers are eaten by tertiary consumers, which are at the top of the food web, such as wading birds, raccoons, and alligators. Each level within the food web is called a trophic level. The flow of energy decreases as it moves up through each level. The channelization of the Kissimmee River had negative impacts on the native wetland plant communities. Amber Moore, FAU's Riverwoods Manager, studies the importance of native and exotic plant communities in the Kissimmee River ecosystem. The Kissimmee River's floodplain vegetation is a critical part of the food web, providing habitat for aquatic invertebrates, fish, wading birds, alligators, snakes, and turtles. The native vegetation includes pickerel weed, maiden cane, smartweed, and spatterdock, which is a native lily with a healthy layer of periphyton algae along its stem. The wetland plants create important habitat, help filter nutrients from the water, prevent erosion with their roots, produce dissolved oxygen through photosynthesis, and are a primary food source. It is important for scientists to monitor the wetland plant communities. Amber also studies the impacts of invasive exotic plants to the Kissimmee River. Over time, exotic plants have invaded the Kissimmee River floodplain. Water lettuce explodes and clogs the river run and blocks the oxygen production.
The invasive exotic species have taken over the Kissimmee River floodplain. For example, we have here West Indian marsh grass that has created a monoculture that is not conducive to the habitat and the native species that forage this area.
The channelization of the Kissimmee River not only changed the plant communities, but also caused dramatic fluctuations in water quality and dissolved oxygen levels. Since 1998, FAU's Center for Environmental Studies has hosted student groups to explore the Kissimmee River via pontoon boat. Let's see how CES teaches students about the importance of water quality for a healthy ecosystem.
Now, the two most important parameters when we're looking at water quality on the Kissimmee River are dissolved oxygen and temperature. And I'm guessing most of you know what temperature is, but you might not be familiar with dissolved oxygen. Now, dissolved oxygen is the amount of oxygen that is in the water and available for fish to breathe. Now, when we measure dissolved oxygen, we talk about it in parts per million. So when scientists test water quality, they use something called a YSI. And we're gonna do the same thing. We're gonna use this YSI today. And this is the sonde. And you're gonna take this sonde and you're gonna dip it down in the water so that it is 1 foot below the water. And then we're gonna read the output for our dissolved oxygen and our temperature on the screen. So what's our reading for dissolved oxygen?
5.82. Mm-hmm. And then for the Celsius, it was 27.1.
Okay.
While scientists use high-tech instruments to measure the water quality, They also use the presence or absence of key aquatic invertebrates in fish to determine the health of the water. After recording dissolved oxygen and temperature, these students are going to get their feet wet, dip netting for aquatic invertebrates in the river. Aquatic invertebrates live in the wetland plant communities and eat algae, plants, and often smaller invertebrates. The invertebrates are the prey for fish, turtles, and birds. Once the students finish dip netting and had collected the fish and aquatic invertebrates in small ID boxes, they gathered on the boat to try and identify each one. The teacher assists her students in identifying their invertebrates.
So now we're done with our dip netting, and I am super excited to see what everybody caught. So you have been given an identification sheet, so I want you to use it, okay? Flip through and see if you can find the little critter that you have in your box, and then I'm gonna come around and I want you guys to tell me what you think you caught.
Golden dot minnow, probably a grass shrimp.
One invertebrate that is an important part of the food web is the apple snail. Alex Dyson is an FAU scientist studying the invasive apple snail.
The Florida apple snail is the largest native freshwater snail in North America at around 2 to 3 inches across. It feeds primarily on underwater algae called periphyton. However, in 2003, an invasion from South America of a non-native apple snail occurred called the island apple snail. This snail eats both native and non-native plant species, which can significantly alter the ecosystem. They can breed year-round, and they lay bright pink egg sacs on floodplain vegetation. The Florida apple snail is found throughout the state in certain populations. However, here on the Kissimmee River, the non-native species is the most dominant. Apple snails serve as the primary food source for the endangered snail kite. Initially, scientists were worried that the invasion of the non-native apple snail would cause a problem to snail kites. So due to this, scientists are studying the interactions and populations of both snail kites and both of the apple snail species. Snail kites use their curved beaks to reach into the apple snail opening called the operculum to eat the snail. The larger the apple snail, the harder it is for them to reach inside and eat it. The non-native snail is much larger, but it turns out that snail kites are actually able to, they're evolving to adapt to eat the larger, more abundant non-native apple snail.
Normally, these kinds of changes in physical characteristics, known as morphology, occur over long periods of time. But scientists are documenting that their beak size has changed rapidly just in the last few years. Now scientists are re-evaluating how to manage for exotic apple snails, since their abundance has helped the endangered snail kite's populations stabilize. The snail kite is just one of the many species of birds that has returned to the Kissimmee River and floodplain. During their field experience on the Kissimmee River, the students learn how to use binoculars to view wading birds along the river. They learn how to identify the different species and then record the diversity and abundance of species on their data sheets.
Wading birds are the top of the food web, and because of this, scientists can use wading birds to get an idea of whether an ecosystem is healthy. Now, they do this by looking at two things. One of the things is diversity, and the other thing is abundance. Now, when we're talking about wading birds, diversity is the number of different species of wading birds that you would find in a particular area. And abundance is the number of each kind of species that you're finding in that area. Now, why this information is useful is because if you take an area like the Kissimmee River and you have a lot of wading birds, that means that you probably also have a lot of invertebrates, as well as fish, because those wading birds need to be eating something, right? And if you have a habitat that has lots of birds and lots of invertebrates and lots of fish, then you most likely have a healthy habitat.
Over the last century, the Kissimmee River has seen many changes. Historically, it was a slow-moving 103-mile-long meandering river that flowed through a wide floodplain filled with an array of wildlife. Then, in the 1960s, the wide 56-mile-long C-38 canal was dug for flood control that drained and dried out the wetland floodplain. The river's banks were turned into pastures for grazing cattle, and little native wildlife remained. In 1999, the Kissimmee River restoration began. To date, 44 miles of windy river and 20,000 acres of floodplain wetlands have been restored. Most of the native wildlife and vegetation has returned to the river thanks to the hard work of dedicated scientists and engineers.
Working on the Kissimmee River Restoration Project has been absolutely wonderful. I think my favorite part is being able to be involved in all the different aspects of the science side of things, with the fish, the birds, the water quality, the plants, everything. And just being able to be out here and be in nature and have this beautiful backdrop for an office. Who wouldn't love it?
Throughout the restoration process, the Kissimmee River has taught us some valuable lessons. The Kissimmee River food web is delicate. When humans disrupt the hydrology of an ecosystem, it also disrupts the balance of the food web. Wetlands play a critical role in protecting our water resources. The wetlands along the Kissimmee River serve as an all-important habitat for wildlife. Even more important for our growing populations, wetlands recharge the aquifers, the source of most of our fresh drinking water in Florida. Flood control and human development can be sustainable. Scientists and engineers have learned a lot since the Kissimmee River was first channelized. Now we are better able to manage water resources while maintaining the delicate balance of our wetland ecosystems. One of the most important lessons we've learned is that we can work together to correct environmental mistakes. The Kissimmee River Restoration provides a global example that restoration works. It has taken years of collaboration between state and federal agencies, scientists, engineers, educators, and residents. However, when we work together in harmony with nature, the Kissimmee River Restoration has shown that wetlands can rebound with improved water quality, native habitats, and abundant wildlife.